Good afternoon, everyone. The topic of today's lecture is chemical disasters. Incidents involving chemical substances occur frequently. There are many real-life examples of chemical incidents. In 1984, the accidental airborne discharge in Bhopal, India, of 25 tons of the pesticide reactive intermediate product methyl isocyanate and caused 2,500 deaths. ₹150,000 injuries and the displacement 200,000 people. In terms of implications for health services, one of the most significant incidents occurred in March 1995, when Zarin nerve agent was deliberately realized in a Tokyo subway system, resulting over 5,000 casualties and including 12 deaths. Over 300 casualties were emergency services personnel, as medical, police, fire agency, who responded to the incident. The low number of deaths from this highly toxic substance was due to a number of factors, not the least being that the Zarin was of low purity and the method of dissemination was rudimentary. There were situations which generated mass physiological and psychological casualties. The alarming number of response agency casualties in the last of these examples indicated the procedures for such incidents were either not developed or not followed. The types of agents which can cause this type of mass casualty incident range from highly toxic commercial chemical substances to specific agents designed for use in warfare, the latter often referred to as weapons of mass destruction. All of these agents pose extreme and widespread hazards. They are difficult to detect and identify and require decontamination to prevent secondary casualties. They are realized may be accidental, deliberate, terrorist-based, or as a result of warfare. Chemical incidents generate mass casualties, including healthcare responders, if appropriate preparation are not taken. Chemical agents comprise a range of chemical substances which may be used to kill, seriously injure, or incapacitate through their physiological effects. Excluded from this definition are riot control agents, herbicides, smoke and flame, although riot control agents will be briefly addressed. Chemical agents in a modern sense were first used during the First World War. They were response for over a million casualties and clearly demonstrated the need of protection from these types of agents. A variety of chemical agents was produced, ranging from chlorine to the blister producing sulfur mustard. Chemical agents were not used in the Second World War, but at the end of the war, stockpiles of newer nerve agents were discovered. They were found to be effective in much lower concentrations than the then-known agents, and nerve agents have now been used in a conflict and by terrorists, notably during the Iran-Iraq war and in the Tokyo subway incident. With increasing industrialization, the real use of chemical agents has also resulted from industrial accidents and occasionally during terrorist incidents. Chemical agents may enter the body by several routes, and the nature and onset of signs and symptoms vary accordingly. Gases, vapors, and aerosols, when inhalated, may be absorbed through any part of the respiratory tract, from the mucosa of nose and mouth to the alveoli of the lungs. They may also be directly absorbed by the eye. Aerosol particles larger than 5 microns tend to be retained in the upper respiratory tract, while those smaller than 1 micron tend to be breathed and out again, although some of these smaller particles may be retained. Droplets of liquid, some vapors, solid particles may be absorbed through the surface of the skin and mucous membranes. Wounds or abrasions present areas which are more permeable than intact skin. Chemical agents may also contaminate food and drink and thus be absorbed by the gastrointestinal tract. The effective use of any chemical agent is depend on its physiological and chemical properties and on environmental conditions. Agents range widely in their physiological properties, such as vapor pressures and densities, boiling points and solubility in water. They are classified as non-persistent if they disperse rapidly after realize, or persistent if they remain in the environment . The chemical properties, such as reactivity and stability, also vary. The effectiveness of an agent is its capacity to produce the maximum number of casualties or amount of disruption with the least amount of agents. Effectiveness depends on criteria such as agent's suitability for particular situation, toxicity, irritancy, and the ability of the target population to neutralize or counter an agent's effects once it has been delivered. Meteorological factors such as wind speed, temperature, precipitation, and atmospheric stability will influence the duration of effectiveness of chemical agents. The dose of chemical agent is expressed as its concentration in an atmosphere multiplied by the time of exposure. Chemical agents are highly toxic and can be rapidly absorbed through the respiratory tract, mucous membranes, skin, and gut. The nerve agents are a group of particularly toxic chemical warfare agents which are related chemically to the organophosphorus insecticides. They are effective in a doses ranging from 10 to 200 milligrams. The principal agents in this group are Tabun, GA, Zarin, GB, Zaman, GD, Cyclozarin, GF, and VX. The G agents tend to be non-persistent, whereas the V agents are persistent. Some G agents may be thickened with vapor substances in order to increase their persistence and therefore their ability to penetrate the intact skin. In a pure state, nerve agents are colorless liquids. In an impure state, nerve agents may be encountered as yellowish to brown liquids. Some have a faintly fruity odor. The effect of the nerve agents are mainly due to their ability to inhibit acetylcholinesterase throughout the body. Since the normal function of this enzyme is to hydrolyze acetylcholine wherever it's realized, such inhibition results in the accumulation of excessive concentration of acetylcholine and it's on its various sites of the action. These sites include the endings of parasympathetic nerves, of the smooth muscles of the iris, ciliary body, bronchial tree, gastrointestinal tract, bladder, blood vessels, salivary glands and the secretory glands of the gastrointestinal and respiratory tract, cardiac muscle and the endings of sympathetic nerves of the sweat glands. The accumulation of acetylcholine at these sites results the characteristic muscarinic signs and symptoms. The accumulation of acetylcholine at the endings of motor nerves to voluntary muscles and in some autonomic ganglia result its nicotinic signs and symptoms. The accumulation of excessive acetylcholine in the brain and spinal cord results in characteristic central nervous system symptoms. The inhibition of acetylcholinesterase by the nerve agents may be irreversible and effects may be prolonged. Clinical effects vary depending on which sites are affected. Following inhalational exposure, casualties may experience a sequence of symptoms and signs which include eye pain, difficulty focusing, headache, rhinorrhea, chest tightness, wheeze, watery secretions from the mouth, difficulty concentrating, anxiety, nausea and vomiting, loss of the bowel and bladder control, muscle fasciculation and twitching, seizures, respiratory failure and death. The progression of sequence will depend on the dose, with high exposure causing seizures within 1 minute. Liquid nerve agent on skin and in wounds is rapidly absorbed and will cause localized sweating and fasciculation and subsequent systemic effects. Death from this exposure to high doses of agent in any form usually results from asphyxia and cardiorespiratory failure. Nerve agents act by stimulating nerve endings to cause excess secretion, muscle spasms, seizures, respiratory failure, and death. Pyridostigmine is available to at-risk personnel as a pretreatment of nerve agent poisoning. Pyridostigmine reversibly binds excess acetylcholinesterase and thus prevents nerve agent from inactivating the enzyme, which is subsequently realized. The dose of pyridostigmine is 13 mg 8 hourly post-exposure treatment consists of atropine, Axim, and anticonvulsants. Atropine is an anticholinergic which reverses muscarinic effects such as excess secretions, sweating, and bradycardia. If given to non-exposed individuals, side effects will include reducing sweating, increasing the risk of heart stress. Axims such as abidoxim reactivate acetylcholinesterase by splitting the bond between the nerve agent and the enzyme, particularly at nicotinic sites. The bond between acetylcholinesterase and Zaman agent rapidly limiting Axim effectiveness. Anticonvulsants such as diazepam reduce seizures and thus central nervous system damage. Mild poisoning causes exhibiting rhinorrhea, headache, excess salivation, dimness of vision, chest tightness, nausea, and localized twitching, are treated with atropine either alone in an intramuscular dose of 2 mg, repeated as necessary, or combined with an Axim. For moderate poisoning, with the additional signs and symptoms of dyspnoea, weakness, muscle fasciculation, further atropine and Axim, usually combined in autoinjector, is given. Severe poisoning cases manifested by confusion, marked dyspnoea, severe miosis, vomiting, involuntary defecation and urination, convulsions, unconsciousness and cardiorespiratory failure are treated with repeated administration of atropine, oxym, and anticonvulsants. This regimen is essential to survival. Oxygen and assisted ventilation may also be required. Adequate atropinization is demonstrated by decreased ventilatory resistance, reduced sweating and tachycardia. Caution should be exercised with intravenous atropine in the presence of hypoxia, as cardiac arrhythmias may result. In moderate and severe cases, treatment should continue for 24 hours. Anesthesia for resuscitative surgery may be complicated by life-saving treatment. Treatment of nerve agent poisoning requires rapid administration of atropine, oxym, and diazepam. Blister agents. The vesicant agents include sulfur mustard, nitrogen mustard, arsenical vesicants as leucite, and the galogenated oximes such as phosgene oxime, whose properties and effects are very different from those of the other vesicants. They are colorless or light colored and have various odors. They pose both liquid and vapor hazards and are highly penetrating and can be not persistent or persistent. Vesicants are very toxic alkalizing agents which damage DNA in rapidly dividing cells, causing cellular death. Clinical effects are delayed for mustard. They include skin burning and blistering, burning of the eyes, mucous membranes and lungs, vomiting and diarrhea, and damage to the blood-forming organs after absorption. The eyes are particularly susceptible and lacrimation. Photophobia and conjunctivitis occur within hours. Erythema and skin itching present within 2-48 hours, followed by appearance of small vesicles which develop into large blisters. Moist areas such as groin and armpit are most affected, and healing may take from weeks to months. Respiratory tract burns present after 4 to 6 hours as rhinorrhea, sneezing, epistaxis, laryngitis, cough and dyspnoea, and followed by pneumonitis, then bronchopneumonia in severe cases. Agent absorption, including through wounds, causes systemic effects. Bone marrow damage results in leukocytosis followed by leukopenia, with severe cases progressing to aplastic anemia. Vomiting, convulsions and cardiac arrhythmias follow by absorption of high doses. Arsenical vesicants and phosgene produce more rapidly progressive, severe and painful lesions. The systemic effects of arsenic include an increase in capillary permeability, leading to gamma concentration, sometimes progressing to shock and death, liver, biliary, and intestinal damage. Vesicants act by damaging cells to cause burns, bone marrow, depression and shock, or major organ injury. There is no specific treatment for vesicants other than leucocyte, for which dimercaprol, British anti-leucocyte, may be used. Immediate decontamination of all vesicants is essential to minimize injury. To be effective, British anti-leucocyte, eye drops and skin ointment must be applied within minutes of exposure. British anti-leucocyte displaces and combines with arsenic to form a water-soluble compound which is then excreted. If systemic poison occurs with leucocyte, as indicated by presence of cough with dyspnoea and fortispatum, a large vesicle which had not been decontaminated earlier, or extensive skin contamination, intravascular British anti-leucocyte should be given. The aim of other therapy is to relieve symptoms, prevent infections, and promote healing. Systemic analgesics are necessary for pain relief. Topical antibiotics and midriatics are required to reduce complication of eye injuries. Skin lesions require careful management, ranging from soothing lesions to debridement, and treatment for any resulting infection. Fluid loss is less than for thermal burns. Respiratory tract lesions require symptomatic treatment, including steam inhalation and codeine for cough, bronchodilators, intubations with succinylcholine and ventilation, and management of infection as required. Inhalated steroids should be considered for phosgene oxime treatment. Systemic effects require supportive care, maintenance of metabolic status, and management of the effects of bone marrow suppression, including treatment of infection and the use of bone marrow stimulators. Treatment of vesicant agent poisoning is largely symptomatic. Chemical lung damaging agents include phosgene, diphosgene, chlorine and chloropicrin. Phosgene is a non-persistent colorless gas which is high vapor density and an odor of new mown hay. Similar substances encountered in fires may also induce lung damage. Lung damaging agents increase the permeability of capillary membranes and cause bronchial epithelial damage, resulting in pulmonary edema, partial atelectasis, and consequent of hypoxia and gamma concentrations. Effects usually reach a maximum at 12 to 24 hours after the exposure. Early symptoms and signs include lacrimation, sneezing, coughing, choking, tightness of the chest, nausea, vomiting and headache. Skin irritation may occur with high doses. Cough, dyspnoea, fruity sputum and wheeze then worsen. Severe cases may result in shock with respiratory and cardiac failure. Survivors may suffer long-term from respiratory sequelae. Lung-damaging agents act by increasing capillary permeability to cause pulmonary edema. Treatment following exposure to lung-damaging agents, including industrial chemicals, involves enforced rest and supportive care, including oxygen and airway support, codeine for cough, fluid replacement and possibly steroids. Antibiotics may be required to treat infection. Chemical blood agents. Cyanide agents include hydrogen cyanide and cyanogen chloride. Hydrogen cyanide is colorless, has an odor of bitter almonds, and is highly volatile and non-persistent. Cyanogen chloride is also highly irritating. Following inhalation, cyanide agents reversibly bind with the cytochrome oxidase system and interfere with oxygen utilization at the cellular level, affecting the respiratory center in particular. In high concentrations, tachypnea commences with a second followed by convulsions, respiratory failure, and death. Lower concentrations may cause weakness, nausea, headache, and agitation with or without progression to convulsions and coma. Cyanogen chloride has additional symptoms, including coughing, dyspnea, and lacrimation, due to the intense local irritation. Survival may be accompanied with pulmonary edema. Cyanide agents act by inhibiting the cytochrome oxidase system to cause the respiratory failure. Treatment of cyanides must be immediate in the event of high exposures. No treatment is required for casualties who are conscious and breathing normally more than 5 minutes after exposure. Oxygen and respiratory support should be administered initially. Decobalt adetate provides binding sites for cyanide ions, allowing for reactivation of cytochrome oxidase. Binding sites are also provided by methemoglobin, which is produced by the administration of sodium nitrite or 4-dimethylaminophenol. Decobalt adetate is given intravenously in doses of 600 mg. The dose of sodium nitrite is 300 mg intravenously over the 3 minutes, and the dose of 4-dimethylaminophenol is 250 mg by the slow intravenous injection. Cyanide detoxification is achieved with sodium thiosulfate, which converts cyanide ions to thiocyanide, which is in turn rapidly excreted. Sodium thiosulfate should be given to supplement all other forms of treatment. The dose of sodium thiosulfate is 12.5 grams intravenously over the 10 minutes. Cyanogen chloride exposure may also require treatment as per lung damaging agent protocols. The treatment of cyanide agent poisoning requires decobalt adetate, sodium nitrite, and sodium thiosulfate. Other possible chemical agents include incapacitants such as 3-quinsidylbenzoate or BZ and D-lysergic acid LSD. Riot control agents such as tear gas CS and MACE CN. And vomiting agents such as diphenylaminarsine or DM. These agents are generally solids which are disseminated as smoke. They are non-persistent and acts by various means to cause transient incapacitation. Treatment is symptomatic. Rapid detection and identification of agents is crucial to appropriate management of casualties. Agent identification determines the level of responder protection required and priorities for immediate treatment and decontamination. Agent monitoring is also essential to ensuring adequacy of decontamination. Agent detection and identification is fundamental to casualty management and responder protection. The use of chemical agent may be suspected based on a presence of large number of known trauma casualties, casualties located in a specific geographical areas, numerous dead animals, evidence of munitions or dispensers, or claims by terrorist groups. Detector papers and kits, drag tubes and electronic instruments such as chemical agent monitor are available for the detection of variety of liquid and vapor, NOV, vesicant, cyanide and lung damaging agents. These devices do not have universal application. Specific agent identification requires specialist equipment and support. Appropriate control of the incident site is essential to the management of chemical agent casualties. Isolation of hazard areas is required based on a detection and identification of agent, and decontamination and treatment areas must be established upwind of the hazard. Emergency service personnel must be protected by the use of personal protective equipment and restriction of exposure. Contaminated casualties should be decontaminated before care is instituted to limit agent absorption. The provision of accurate casualty advice to hospitals will also be required to enable preparation to be made. As hospitals will likely receive contaminated casualties directly, they must be prepared to undertake all components of casualty management with their own resources. Triage of mass casualties will be essential to ensure the optimum utilization of health resources. Where appropriate, specific antidotes must be given rapidly, based on clinical presentation alone if necessary, to ensure survival. Once this is achieved, triage may be directed towards combined injuries. Further basic and advanced life support treatment and evacuation will follow. Continued supportive and definitive care utilizing hospital facilities will likely be required for severe NOV and vesicant agent casualties. Psychological cases will complicate casualty management, especially as diagnosis may be difficult. The provision of accurate and detailed information to the media and the public on the type of nature of agents, their distribution, effects and treatment, including the contamination requirements, will be essential to limit distress and panic. The key elements of management of chemical incident are incident site control, casualty triage, decontamination and treatment, and communication. That's all. Thank you for your attention.